King James only. It just means that that's what we chose today. And Book of Ephesians chapter 1, as you may or may not know, this is a letter written to a church in Asia Minor, the church at Ephesus. And I want to just, how many know we come to church to hear the word of God? How many know that? We don't come to church to be entertained. If I want to be entertained, I can go to a comedy club. I can go to a movie. I come to the house of God to know the Word of God. Because it's the Word of God that can change me. Amen. And so I pray that you don't come with the mindset of being entertained. Sometimes I even said to myself, I'm purposely going to be boring so that I can step outside and allow God to shine. Amen. That's really how the church ought to be. Unfortunately, what we have in the church nowadays is nothing more at times than an entertainment center. I try not to do that. I try not to do that. Now, it may come out entertaining at times, but it's not intentional. Amen. Ephesians 1, please. Ephesians 1. And I'm going to speak to you this morning on the believer's spiritual blessing. How many want to be blessed? Amen. I want to be blessed. Here's another thing that the church has done. It has turned blessings to nothing more than... it has reduced it to something, nothing more than materialism. And when I read scripture, I find something quite different. And I want to minister, I have a little buzz up here, amen, just a hair of a buzz. And I'm not talking about me buzzing, amen. I haven't buzzed that way for 30-something years, hallelujah, almost 40 years. I've got to clarify that because sometimes new people come to the church and they say, well, the pastor was buzzed. No, I don't know what buzzing is anymore. When Jesus delivered me from alcohol, he delivered me from alcohol. Amen. I have trouble understanding how today we have sipping saints and all of that. Amen. When I got delivered from vodka and all of the drinks that we would drink, I got set free, praise God. Amen. I went home and I got to my house and I took every beer bottle I could find and I dumped it down the toilet. Amen. There was not a secret stash anywhere. I got home and I cleaned my house. Glory to God. Because when you are truly born again, you want to please God. Amen. There was no more nightclubbing. Amen. There was no more going out. It was just I gave my life to Jesus. And to give your life to Jesus, and that you give your life to to Jesus, and that's it, man. The old life was gone, and the new life had came. Glory to God. That's what happened when you. That's what's supposed to happen when you give your life to the Lord. The problem today is that we got a lot of saints that they're trying to see how close they can get to the edge of the world and still be saved. Folks, Jesus said, you are not of this world. If you were of this world, the world would love you. But because you're not of this world, the world will hate you, amen? Because you don't do the things you used to do. You don't act the way you used to act. You don't drink the way you used to drink. Amen, you just don't do that anymore. We're born again. We're saved. We're washed in the blood of the Lamb. Glory. Now that's not my sermon this morning, though I feel like it being my sermon, amen, I feel like adopting it, but that's not what we're here to do. The book of Ephesians, so I want to talk to you for a few moments on the believer's blessing, the believer's blessings. I want you to know whether you feel blessed or not, you are, as a believer. I want to give you an upfront disclosure and let you know that this is applicable only to those who have surrendered their hearts to Jesus. And this morning you'll have an opportunity to do that. The book of Ephesians chapter 1, Paul is the writer, and he is writing to a church in Ephesus, Asia Minor. And I'm just going to start reading, and I'm going to ask you to follow along with me, above me if you have no Bible. You can follow above me. It says, Paul, verse 1, Ephesians 1. Paul, the author. The name Paul here, his name means little. That's what his name means, little. It's interesting, but when we come to Christ, we ought not to think that we're all that. We ought to think that what we are because of who he is. We are small, but he is great. Amen. Paul, when his mother named him, now you have to understand this. When his mother, when she was incubating this boy in her womb, and the boy came out, and mom said, what are we going to name him? The dad says, he's quite short. Why don't we call him Little? Now, how many know, amen, I would hate for you to name your son or daughter Little, amen, or Stuart Little, or whatever, amen, but this is the name that his parents gave him, Little. But it doesn't matter what you were told you were, because this man became the greatest man in the Bible, amen. He wrote one-third of the New Testament, because in his deficiencies, Christ became great in him. In fact, when he compares himself with the other apostles, he says, although I am the least of all of them, he said, by the grace that was given to me, he says, I preach the boundless riches of Christ's gospel. He says, I'm the least of all of them. He said, but I have done more than all of them. I don't care if you were born with a handicap. You can do more than the common man when you allow the grace of God to work through you. I don't care if you were blind, naked. I don't care how you were born. When you come to Jesus Christ, Christ can do great things through you. He says, Paul, the writer, the author, an apostle, the word apostle there is apostolos in the original writing, and it means simply a messenger, or he that is sent by God, he that is sent. He said, I am little, but I was sent by God. I am insignificant, but God sent me somewhere. He made me a messenger of him. How many know that when God's looking for messengers, he doesn't always look for the tallest, And the most handsome, though he did that with me. Amen. But he looks for anyone who is available and is willing to surrender their lives to him. Amen. The Bible says that when the prophet went to the house of Jesse, the Lord told him, I want you to go to the house of Jesse because there is someone there I want to anoint as the king of Israel. The father Jesse lined up all his children from the youngest to the oldest, and the prophet walked in and they were all handsome, tall warriors. And the Bible says that the prophet went through the first one and said, that's not him. And to the next one, and the Lord said, that's not him. He went through all the sons and he thought maybe God made a mistake. So he goes and he asks the father, do you have any other sons? Because the Lord specifically told me to come to this house and anoint the next king of Israel. And the father said, yeah, we have a little son, the youngest of all. His name is David, but he's out in the fields tending sheep. He's just a mocoso. He says, bring him in. And the Bible says that the moment that boy walks into that room, the Spirit of the living God said, I did not choose any of those sons of Jesse, but that's the one I chose. Amen. That's the one I want. And I want you to know something. That if you're here today and you feel like God can't use you because of the mistakes that you made or the way you live your life, I want you to know that the worse you are, the best you are sometimes. God can use you and wants to use you and will use you. So Paul is saying, little and apostolos, I'm a messenger of Jesus, that name. Jesus. You can talk to people about Buddha and they don't get angry with you. You can talk to them about Confucius and they won't get angry with you. You can talk to them about the name of God and they have no problem with it. But the minute you mention that name, Jesus, all hell trembles. Demons begin to shake in their boots, amen. All hell begins to move in craziness because they don't know what to do with that name. I'm reminded of when the sons of Ziba went out to try to cast devils. The Bible says that they went to try to cast a demon out of somebody, and the demon spoke and said, well, we know Paul in hell, and we know Jesus, but who are you? They know Jesus in hell, folks. The question is, do they know you? I hope they know you. I hope that when they make mention of you, the demons get concerned. I pray that when they mention your name, all hell begins to say, we got to strategize. We don't want to hear that guy's name because he's crazy for the Lord. He's insane. We know that if we let him go on, he may cause some damage to the kingdom of God, the kingdom of hell. That's the way we ought to live. We ought to live in the cutting edge of everything God is doing. We ought to live in the cutting edge, amen. We ought to make sure that hell is afraid of us. They're afraid of Jesus. Paul says, Paul, an apostolos of Jesus, Jesus. The word Jesus is a Greek word and our word in here, and it means Joshua. It comes from a Hebrew origin that's Jehoshua. And it's the same exact name, or the tetragrammaton, the same name that is assigned to Jehovah God. Wow. Wow. And it literally just means Jehovah God saves. So when you hear the name Jesus, it simply means Jehovah God saves. He'll save you from your sins.
Come on.
He'll a callous heart, he'll save you from the very pit of hell, because that is who he is. He is the Savior of the world. That's why when Jesus was being born, they said, what are we going to name him? Joseph was thinking of all kinds of names. We'll name him after Joseph, after dad. Joseph Jr., Joe Jr. I have no doubt they had other names for him. But the Bible says that the angel of the Lord came down and he says, you're not going to name him anything. What you're going to name him is Jesus. He says, because he is the Savior of the world. Amen. Hallelujah. You're going to name him Jesus because he came to save the world. Came to save your family. Came to save your children. Came to save your wife. Came to save your husband. Oh, I took my husband to AA and they couldn't help him. I took him to NA and he got worse. But when he came to Jesus, Jesus saved him. Jesus delivered him. Gee, and now he's crazy. And now he's insane. And now he thinks he wants to be a preacher. Jesus. Paul says, Paulus, author, little, apostolos, messenger of Jesus, Christos, Christ, Jesus, Christ, Jesus, Christos. Christos, Christ, means Messiah, Messiah, anointed one. He says, I am his messenger. Little I am, but I'm his messenger. You can be his messenger. When you leave here today and you go out to eat something at Hometown Buffet and you got your plate out and you're getting some corn, then you put a little bit of lettuce, and you put a little bit of carne asada, and you put everything that you put on that Hometown, and your plate looks like a mountain. Folks, let me tell you, you can go back. You don't have to take it all at once. You can take second and third trips, and you go up to the front to pay, and they ask you, do you need a soda? You tell them, I don't need a soda. Water will do fine, but I want to tell you what you might be needing. You need the messenger of God to get a hold of your heart. I want to tell you about Jesus Christ. He is the one that can save you. He is the one that can deliver you. He is the one that can make you joyful when you're all bummed out. Amen. And you can be his messenger. You can be his messenger. He says, I am the messenger of Jesus Christ. And then he says, by the will of Theos God. Will, thelema, thelema, means the desire, the pleasure, or the determination of God. He's saying, little has become a messenger of Theos God by his desire. You can't choose to be a messenger. It's chosen for you. You can't choose to be a pastor. It's chosen for you. You can't say, I'm going to be an evangelist and go out and travel the world. Friends, that's chosen for us by God. Now, you may not be an apostle, but you may be a nurse. And I want to let you know something, that there is a misconception in the church that the only calling that God does is to be an apostle or a pastor. If you're here today and you are a nurse, that is your high calling. You are helping people. You are blessing people. You are healing people in the name of Jesus. That is a high calling. You're here and you're a businessman. Oh, bless God, we need businessmen. That is your high calling. Don't try to be of God. We need nurses in the kingdom of God. We need businessmen in the kingdom of God. If everybody was an apostle and everybody was a pastor, where would the doctors be?
Come on. Right. Come on. That's good.
So be who you are.
Yes. Praise God.
But whatever you are, be a messenger.
Yes. Yes.
He says, I am an apostle by the determination, the will of God. This is why the book of Hebrews says no one takes his honor upon himself. He must be called of God. Now he says who he's writing to. He says, I'm writing to the saints. Saints. Now let me pause there. He's writing to the saints. The church has done a horrible job in interpreting what a saint is. We have erected monuments and statues because we think that a saint is someone who's done something great and wonderful for God. But I want you to know something, that if you're here today and you've given your life to Jesus Christ, the Bible says that you are a saint, friend. The Bible says you are a saint. And when you gave your life to the Lord and you got baptized in the water and you got filled with the Holy Ghost, the Bible says you're no longer a sinner, you're a saint.
Right.
Come on.
Could be Saint Manuel. Saint Escatel. Saint Ivan. Saint Omar. Saint Melissa. Doesn't mean you're going to come in and we're going to put statues up. It just means you are a saint. He says, he's writing, you have to remember, he's writing to the church and he says to the saints. Now interesting, the word he uses for saints is hagios. It means holy.
Wow. Mm.
And this is, he's saying, to the holy.
Mm. Come on.
Do you feel holy?
Yeah.
Most of the time, we don't feel holy. We feel horrible.
Yeah.
We feel like sinners,
yeah.
Don't we? But he's clarifying. And the word that he uses is holy and blameless.
Wow.
He's writing a letter to the church and he's reminding them, you are holy and you are blameless.
Wow. Praise God.
Pastor, you don't know what I did before I came to church. You are holy and you are blameless in the eyes of God. Not because the preacher said, because the word of God says who we are. In Christ, we are holy and blameless. Why? Because Jesus paid for my past, present, and sins in the future that I have not yet committed. And that's why he makes me holy. Why is it important for us to see ourselves as holy? Our perspectives influences our behavior. If you always see yourself as a sinner, you're going to sin. But if you view yourself as holy and blameless, you're going to live right. This is why Solomon said in Proverbs 23:7, he says, for as he thinks in his heart, that's what he is. So if I think I'm defeated, I am. If I think I can't, I won't. If I think it's impossible, I'll never try. If I think I'm a sinner, I'm going to live like a sinner. But if I think that I'm a saint, holy, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, forgiven, I know who I am. I've got my identity. My identity is not what happens. Amen. Horizontally, my identity comes in my relationship with God. I know who I am.
Man, praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
I see people getting tattoos, sinner. Well, that's old.
Come on.
You ought to be getting one that says, if you're going to get one, which I don't recommend that you do, you ought to get one that says, saint. I'm a saint.
God.
I'm a saint. Now, I look at you, you don't look like a saint. In fact, it's scary to look at you and think that God considers you a saint. But he does. He says that you are a saint. He says, to the saints at Ephesus, a city in Asia Minor, the faithful, pistos, which means believe and trustworthy. Saints ought to be trustworthy. He says, grace and peace from God, our Father, and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Grace, charis, favor, peace, eleni, rest, quietness, and peace. He says, peace, quietness, and rest to you from our Father.
Come on.
We live in a turbulent world. I need peace. I need peace. I need to be able to go to bed at night and get some rest. Last night, peace and rest. Last night, our neighbors had a party. Must have been a Halloween party. Now I know sinners don't go to church. Saints do. And I heard it all night. Boom, kaka, paka, boom, kaka, paka, boom, ba, hinda, paka, tatoa, hinda, patata. I mean, rap music, and on and on and on and on. It's like, and then, you know, and then there was rock and roll, and what, 10 o'clock in the morning, in the evening, and I said, it's all right, amen, praise God. They'll come down in a few minutes at 11 o'clock, and then they yell, ah! I mean, and then it was 11:30, 12 o'clock, I said, they're not going to stop. They're not going to stop. I was in my pajamas. I was not going to go out, so I did the next best thing. I paid my taxes. In fact, I just paid my property taxes. I picked up the phone and called the La Mirada Police Department. I said, my neighbors don't let me sleep. This is 12 o'clock. I waited until 12 o'clock. He says, sir, today is a very busy day. We'll get there as soon as possible. I said, you need to get there ASAP. I gotta get up tomorrow. And my mind, I think, I'm a saint. Amen. Saints can't lose their beauty sleep. Glory to God. And so at 1:30, 1 o'clock, nothing. And they're going on and on. The party, and I mean, I'm turning and twisting. I put some sermon to try to drown it out, but now the sermon doesn't let me sleep in it. Now I got people yelling, music going, and some preacher preaching in my ear at the same time. 2 o'clock, still no cops. 2:30, still no cops. 2:45, no cops. 3 o'clock. In the morning, peace. And I said, well, praise God. Now I can rest. Peace and quietness. Right then, my wife begins to snore. Right there, 3 o'clock. I said, I'm going to call the cops on her. Get her arrested, amen. Get her out of the house. About 3:45, I finally got some shut eye. My wife says, how did you sleep? Don't ask. I learned every rap song on the radio. We got North Korea threatening to literally disintegrate the U.S. They're threatening to put a nuclear missile in the mainland. If you don't know where the mainland is, you're sitting in it. Yep. That's turbulent. Paul said, peace, quietness, and rest comes from the Father. My Papa. My Papa, Abba, can give me peace in the middle of any storm. Any storm. The disciples are in a boat. You know the story. A storm rose up against them and beat against the little boat. They woke up Jesus, frantically afraid. Lord, don't you care if we die? Don't you care if we perish? And the Bible says that Jesus stood in the back of that boat and said, peace, be still. He's your peace. He's your rest. Paul is saying to the church, peace and rest to the saints. Grace to the saints. Amen. Moving on, please. Verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessing in high places in Christ. Paul is saying, first, blessed be God. Blessed be the Father. When we come to church, saints, we need to come with one purpose in mind. We come first to bless God. I come through the doors of this church primarily, first and foremost. Most of the time, people come to church, as I said earlier, to be entertained, to receive something. And no doubt that you ought not to, that you shouldn't come to receive from God. But our first order of service as saints of God is to come in through the doors of this church and say, God, today I'm going to bless you. You've been a blessing to me. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to praise you. I'm going to give blessings unto you. Amen. That's what he says. Blessed. Blessed be the God and Father. And the word blessed there, it's nothing to do with materialism. It's the word eulogitos. It's where we get the word eulogy. Ever been to a eulogy in a funeral where you come in and they have a eulogy? Comes from two root words, eu, which means good or well, and logos, which means word. In essence, really what it means is to speak well of somebody. This is what happens in funerals. You go in. And you know that the guy lived a horrible life, left his wife, left his children, smoked all his life, was a liar, a thief, stole from you, and yet somebody stands up there in the eulogy and begins to say how nice they were. They would speak well of them. Well, he was a good father. No, he wasn't. He was a deadbeat dad. Well, he was a good husband. No, he wasn't. He cheated on his wife 85 times. And they talk. So what Paul is saying is that when we come to the house of God, we ought to bless God. We ought to speak well of him. Because he's the only one that really deserves to be spoken well of. Meaning when I walk in here, I thank God because he is good. I praise you, God, because you are wonderful. I thank you, Father, because you are awesome. You are omniscient. You know all things. You are omnipotent. You are all powerful. God, you are omnipresent. You are everywhere. Blessed be your name. I'm speaking well of you. Listen, if you want to have church, this is the way you have church. You come in, and I see some people walking into the church, and it looks like you've been baptized in battery acid. book of the Bible. But I thank God I never was good at working, never had a job in my life. But since I came to Jesus, the Father gave me a job. Father, thank you. I'm speaking well of him. I want to praise God because he gave me a wife. Amen. Nobody would have looked at you in their right mind. You're not that good looking. Amen. But God had to blind your wife's eye so she can look at something good in you. Oh, when you come in, you say, God, thank you, Lord, that you blinded my wife. You are good, Lord. He gave you children, amen. Children, they may not be the best children. In fact, they give you headaches. They irritate you. But thank God he gave you children. You could have been there. Hallelujah. And so when you come, hallelujah. So when you come in, you're going to bless God for your children. Lord, thank you for Junior. Thank you for Paquito. Oh, God, Paquito is such a headache, but I thank you for Paquito. Thank you for Marilena. Dios, oh, Señor, te gracias por Marilena. Oh, she's a Lord. She's an ugly duckling, Lord, but I thank you for her. Amen. So you come in. When you come into the house of God, you come in with praises. This is why David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. Because you come in with praises in your lips and in your heart. We don't come here to work. We don't come here to work. We come here to bless God. To bless God. My arms still work. My heart's still moving. You could have woke up this morning and yellow chalk all around you, amen. But I thank God that I got up this morning and I'm okay. I thank God I'm not in the drug house. I thank God I'm not in the connection. I thank God, amen, I'm not dead. I thank God I'm not in the morgue. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive. I come into your house to bless you, to bless you, to bless you, to bless you, to speak good things about you. Guarantee you come in with that attitude. No one will irritate you. Because you're too busy blessing God. So he says, blessed. Eulogy. Speak well of God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Watch this. Who has blessed us. First order of service is to bless him. Second order of service is for him to bless us. Who has blessed us? How? Same word. Eulogos. Eulogy. He speaks well of us. He speaks well of you. He says, oh, Freddy. Como te quiero.
Hallelujah.
He speaks well of you.
Yes.
He says, oh, Larry Mendoza. Love is in the air. Every time you turn around, love is in the air. When you're up and when you're down, love is in the air. When you come into his house, because love is in the air. For every vato loco, so first we speak well of him, then he speaks well of us. Don't think that God speaks evil of you. He speaks good of you. He speaks well of you. That's what he says. Blessed be the Father, and blessed be us. Who has blessed us with all spiritual blessing. Here is where the blessing comes in. He says he has blessed us And I've got to finish here in just a moment. Blessed us with all spiritual blessings. You want to know what your blessings are? Here is not dealing with materialism. He says, spiritual blessings. Our blessings are spiritual. We think that if we have a home, we are blessed. No doubt that God does bless physically and materially. But that is not the first order of blessing. He blesses us. He blesses us with all spiritual.
Yes. Yes.
Pneumaticos is the correct Greek. It means breath, wind, blast of air. Spiritual blessings. What do you think Jesus said? Do not store for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, but store for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy and where thieves cannot break in and steal. What he's saying is this: your real treasure has nothing to do with the junk that you accumulate while you're passing through this planet. Your real blessings are eternal. Eternal blessings. Spiritual blessings. What are these spiritual blessings? I'll take 5 minutes and I'll give them to you. Let me give you some spiritual blessings that are ours as believers. One, we are chosen by God with a purpose. Verse 4 of our text. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundations of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Here is spiritual blessing number one. God says, this is your blessing. I chose you. Amen. And I chose you before the foundations of the world. Can a man resist God? No, friend. The reason you are here, it's not because someone invited you. The reason you are here is because God chose you. He chose you not today, not yesterday. The Bible says he chose you before the foundations of the world. Before your mama was born, he chose you. Before your grandpa was, before your grandpa was born, he had already chosen you. Before Jesus came into the world, he had already chosen you. That's why Jesus tells his disciples, you didn't choose me. I chose you. I chose you. Now, why did he choose us? He says it in verse 4. He says, so that we should be holy, hagios, blameless, without blame before him in love. We gotta love each other. That's why we were chosen. We were chosen to love each other. I don't like you, Pastor. Your problem. Maybe you're not chosen. We're chosen to love each other. We're chosen to live holy.
Amen.
We're chosen to live holy and blameless. Blessing number two. I'm almost done. We were adopted by God as his children. Look at verse 5. Having predestined us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to God's pleasure and his will. You know what a blessing, let me tell you what your blessing is? It's not your new car. It's not your new house. It's the fact that God adopted you. You're adopted. Here is a blessing that you're not a bastard. You're not a bastard anymore. You're not an illegitimate child. But God saw you and he said, that boy got no daddy. I'm going to be his daddy. God saw you and said, that girl got no mama, but I'm was adopted. And I can look at you all, and I know we were all adopted. Because you don't all look like you came from the same family. You got white and yellow and black and green and Cuban and Mexican. I mean, what a mixture, man. But I thank God that when God chose people, he didn't choose them based on creed or color. This is why, amen, there is multicolorism in the kingdom of God, amen. But we're all brothers and sisters in the Lord, and God chose us and made us part of the family. Now, we know in the family, there's always some that give you trouble. You got the sons. You got the son that takes out the trash without having to be asked. And you got the one that just keeps piling it in and just won't do nothing about it. And we almost want to just say, hey, buddy, pack up your backpack, find a place to live. But when God chose us, he made us part of his family. There's an old song that says, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain. I've been cleansed by his blood. I'm a joint heir with Jesus as we travel in God. For I'm glad I'm a part of the family of God. I want to live the way he wants me to live. I want to give till there's no more to give. I'm a joint heir with Jesus as we travel inside. For I'm glad we're a part of the family of God. Amen. That's your spiritual blessing. You got a family. You were adopted. You were adopted. God went to the adoption agency and he saw all the nice people. Right? And they said, no. Show me all the ones that nobody wants to adopt. He says, no, you don't want to see them. They're locked up over there. They're all the rejects. All the ones with problems. All the ones with issues. And Jesus said, take me to that room. He says, how many of them you want? So I'll take them all. I'll take them all. Pile them up at the pickup. We're taking them home. And like a bunch of Tijuaneros, amen, in the back of the truck, glory to God. Amen. Driving down the 5 freeway from Tijuana, glory to God, amen. There comes a ball, amen, of losers, glory to God. But they're all heading because they're all part of the family of God. We are the family of God. We are the children of God. Amen. So we're adopted. Thirdly, I'm done. Just hang in there. And this is a great message. It's biblical. You're learning the Bible from what God's saying. We have redemption through the blood of Jesus. We have redemption. Verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. What is this word redemption? ransom, to release a person who is in bondage or a slave. In the days of Jesus, they would have marketplaces where they would take slaves and they would sell them to the public, men and women and children. Just a couple hundred years ago, we made the same stupid mistakes. I want you to know something. No one ought to be a slave to any man. The only slave that we ought to be is a slave, a doulos, to God. There is no room for that anywhere in society. But in the Bible, it doesn't mean that the Bible approved of it. It just made record of what was already happening. In Bible times, you can go into the market and buy a slave. Does it mean God approved of it? He hated it. When it says that we have redemption through Christ, it means we have ransom. What it literally means is this, is that Christ went into the marketplace where sinners were being sold in bondage. And he said, I'll pay the price. I'll buy them. But I will set them free. That's why the Bible says that he who sins is a slave to sin. But Christ came to set sinners free, of whom I am the chief. That's what it means. This is the spiritual blessing that God gives us. That you are free. It's tragic when I see Christians be enslaved once more in the grapples of sin. He set you free. He paid the ransom. Live free. Live free. Number four, we have a great inheritance. Last one. This is my last one. I quit. We have a great inheritance. We have been given a great inheritance. What is that inheritance? This is our spiritual blessings. It is an inheritance that cannot perish, cannot be spoiled. It's unfading and is waiting in heaven for us. It is eternal life. This is your spiritual blessing, that we're going to live forever. Now, believe me, there are people I wish wouldn't live forever. Really. But the way God looks at us, it's not the way I look at us. 1 Peter 1:3-5. As I close, praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and not into an inheritance that can perish or spoil or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last days. What is Peter saying? He's saying this, that God has kept something in heaven for you that cannot spoil, that cannot fade, that cannot be done away with. That is your eternal life. It is waiting when we die. Glory to God. This is our spiritual blessing, that when I die, I'm going to live eternally. I'm going to live in the presence of God. I'm going to live in the kingdom of God forever and forever. Amen. This is our spiritual blessing. Come on. I'm going to leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. That's why the old song says, take this whole world and just give me Jesus. Come on. Eternal life. Some of us are closer to eternal life than others. Don't fear. Don't fear. Because when we die, we'll go into the presence of God, where there'll be no more tears, no more sorrows, no more pain. And so we shall ever be with the Lord. So what is my responsibility as I pass through this planet? What should be my response as a believer considering the spiritual blessings I've been given? One simple: glorify God in your body. Take this temple and use it for His glory. Take this temple that's been redeemed, released, freed, and use it to glorify you. I leave you with the words of the Apostle Paul to the church at Corinth. What? He says, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God? You are not your own. You are not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Paul is saying, your body is not yours. How dare you spend it in what you want to do? He says, your spirit doesn't belong to you. How dare you do with it whatever you want to do? He says, it was bought. It was purchased. And our order of responsibility is to glorify God with this body and with this spirit, because they belong to God. We've been given gifts only that we may give back to Him that which He gave to us. We're going to sing a song. I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet for me.